Welcome back. Today we are going to learn about a topic that's confusing for many students, internal derangement. I hope you have watched the previous videos on TMJ, and if not, I'll put those links in the description below. And before we start, I want to ask you guys for a small favor. Please subscribe to the channel and share this channel with as many of your dental friends as you can. And now let's begin. So let's get to the terminology. What is derangement? Think about a machine. It's working fine, but if you throw a stone in here, there will be a mechanical disturbance, right? Or if some part of the machine gets loose or doesn't work, then the rest of the machine will not work. And this is what will create a mechanical disturbance. That's what the term derangement means. Mechanical disturbance. In case of TMJ, internal derangement means there is a localized mechanical fault which is interfering with smooth joint movement. So the joint is not functioning as it should. The thing that is causing this interference is most often the malpositioned articular disc. The disc can be displaced in any direction, but the most common is anteromedial displacement. Before we go ahead, let's look at the normal position of the disc. In a normal TMJ, the posterior band is in 12 o'clock position, means it is sitting above the condylar head, and the intermediate zone, that is the middle part of the disc, is situated in 1 o'clock position. When you open the jaw, the disc condyle complex translates in a forward direction, means they slide along the articular eminence. So this image shows what happens during opening. And this is showing maximal open position. You can see that the condyle stays in constant contact with the thin intermediate zone while opening and also on maximal open position. So this is very important to remember what happens during normal joint movement. The condyle is in contact with the thin intermediate zone at all phases of opening and closing. The superior and inferior retrodiscal lamina means this portion also has an important part in the way the disc moves along with the condyle. At first, while opening, the disc moves passively with the condyle, and this stretches this superior lamina of the retrodiscal tissue, and this pulls the disc posteriorly in relation to the condyle. That's why, although the condyle rotates forwards, the disc relatively rotates in a posterior direction over the condyle. So I'll repeat this point again. The thing you should remember here is that in a normal joint, the thin intermediate zone of the disc is always interposed between the condyle and the temporal bone during all phases of opening and closing. This is to protect the articular surfaces when the joint is in function. So you can see that because of the constant contact of the condyle with the intermediate zone, there will be no friction between the condyle and the articular fossa. Now we just learned that the most common type is anterior disc displacement, right? So let's see what happens during anterior disc displacement. In anterior disc displacement, the disc is positioned anterior and medial to the condyle in closed mouth position. So you can see how this looks different than normal position. In normal position, the posterior band sits right on top of the condylar head. And in anterior disc displacement, it is situated anterior to the condyle. Now in this case, when you open the mouth, the condyle moves over the posterior band of the disc. So it kind of snaps under the posterior band, which creates the clicking noise. And now the disc is back to its normal position on top of the condyle. That's why it's called as disc displacement with reduction. Because the disc is reduced to a normal position for the remaining part of the opening cycle. You can see this is the maximal opening position. On closing the mouth, the disc will slip off the condyle and again it returns to its anterior position. This can also create the clicking sound. When clicking happens both during opening and closing, it's called as reciprocal click. In case of anterior disc displacement without reduction, the condyle is unable to snap back underneath the disc. So the disc doesn't reduce back on top of the condyle while opening the mouth. You can see that here. When the condyle begins to translate forwards, means when the jaw is just opening, the disc remains anterior to the condyle, and even on maximal opening, it is still anterior to the condyle. And posterior attachment tissue is interposed between the condyle and the fossa. So in this case, there will be no clicking because the condyle cannot go over the posterior band. This condition is called as closed lock. So in this case, you can see that the disc doesn't allow the condyle to translate along the articular eminence. Usually in this case, the disc has lost its normal biconcave shape and it's rather thick, which is why the condyle cannot negotiate around it. In some patients, if they have disc displacement with reduction, it can progress to disc displacement without reduction. So in patients who have disc displacement without reduction, they will often have a history of clicking, but when they progress to non-reducing disc displacement, they won't have clicking noise. I hope you are not confused. What I mean to say is, in case of anterior disc displacement without reduction, there will be no clicking noise. But the patient might have a history of clicking. So that means the patient had disc displacement with reduction previously, and now it has progressed to disc displacement without reduction. That's why now they no longer have clicking noise. Since the disc is not allowing the condyle to move over the articular eminence, there will obviously be limited mouth opening here, right? If this happens suddenly and there is limited mouth opening of less than 25 millimeters, it's called as acute closed lock. If the disc displacement has occurred on the right side, the mandible will deflect to right side and lateral movements to the left side will be limited. So whichever side the disc displacement has occurred, the mandible will deflect to that side and lateral movement to the opposite side will be limited. In chronic closed lock, there will be a history of sudden onset of limited mouth opening. That means the patient had acute closed lock that stayed that way for a long time, and when it's over 4 months of limited mouth opening, it's considered as chronic closed lock. So I hope you got an idea about what internal derangement is all about. When you understand the basic concepts, the rest of the things like treatment plan will be very easy to understand. I hope you enjoyed learning with me today. Please do subscribe and share this channel with fellow dentists and dental students, and I'll see you very soon. Bye.